so frustrated. Like, all of this is like for Black people, you got to understand, Black Americans right now, we want the CBC gone. This is one of the things that white people say to me, well, the CBC has like 53 seats and they're not. And I'm like, first of all, the majority of the CBC are Black immigrants. Sorry, here we go again. I hate to keep bringing this up, but there's a reason they don't care about Black American issues. And also, the money is in the people of color. It's not in Black stuff. I had a friend who used to work at a nonprofit. I'm not going to name the nonprofit, but when people would come in with projects that were Black targeted, they would try to push them towards doing people of color. People who are Latinos could come in and have a project for Latinos, and they would push it as a Latino project and give them all funding in the world. Like, Black people have to be people of color. People of color get to be their ethnicity. Like, that's what's going on with that too. So they're focused on other groups instead of us. Like, how much have you even heard the CBC talk about reparations or push reparations? But you heard them talking about doing a equality act, doing like an equality act over here for this group or for that group. And this thing, I'm not against you doing stuff for other people, but why is it you have to be the leader of it? Like, there's all these people of color and white people in Congress, but y'all always have to be the face of those things instead of taking care of your own group, or at least trying to, especially for people who live in Black districts. If you're a Black congressperson and you live in a mixed district, of course you should be making sure that you're tending to everybody's needs. But you also have to make sure that you're fixing your own people. Like, what's the point of having all these Black faces in high places when we're in a worse situation than we were in the 60s? Like, it's just fake.
I think that there
I
is
don't feel
a,
like I have representation.
and I think that there's a huge tie-in here to the fact that this all connects back to the Democratic Party establishment. And why is that? Because over 90, unconscionably, that the number is this high, with all due respect. But the fact that over 90% of the Black population in the United States votes Democrat every single election, what do you think is going to
Oh,
happen? You are a slave to the Democratic Party. They don't owe you ish, ish. You have already given away the farm. You're like, oh, I'll vote for you no matter what you
Yeah,
do.
giving away the milk for free. No, it's so funny that you said that. There was literally this Hispanic dude on Twitter, and he was like, no, Latinos are going to keep their vote split. We learned from what you did to the Blacks. We're not stupid. I had to laugh. All I could do was laugh because he's not wrong.
No.
Like,
No, it's not wrong. And I've come to the realization, the Congressional Black Caucus
let's have a
is
look.
just, wait, don't do that while I'm talking. The Congressional Black Caucus is just a caucus of Black people. That's it. They don't
That's it.
serve
Black skin
the
people.
Black, they just all happen to be Black. They don't serve those interests. They don't fight for those issues. And the fact that I
They
will
might as well
never
just did a caucus on bowling.
Well, it doesn't matter, right? They just happen to be Black. It doesn't serve anything. When they endorsed Elliot Engel over Jamal Bowman, that was it for me. And now that Jamal Bowman is in there, I am so dying to have him on the show and ask him, are you now a member of the Congressional Black Caucus? I'm sure he is. And what's that like now that you're in the caucus with the people that were endorsing Elliot Engel against you? Like, I cannot stand that caucus, and I'm not even really allowed to say that out loud. There, I said it.
Well, let me tell you something. When we get back into the White House in 24, and we're totally getting back there, believe me when I tell you, the Blacks love me. They know I'm a great guy. What do you have to
And the
lose?
gag is, it, I could see, I could literally see like 15% going for Trump on Black people. Black people are pissed.
Well, I'm
Like, they're
really great
mad.
for
They're
them.
mad all across the board.
Sam, tell
As well, they should be.
Sam, I'm going to hire you. You're going to be great on this campaign. We're winning California this time.
See,
We're going to work everybody.
this is a thing. I can't be a Republican because I don't hate Black people. Like, the Black Republicans that they push to the prominence, you have to talk down and hate Black people. I can't do all of that. Like, that, you
And
know.
that's
It's
how it is
not.
here locally
That's
too, is why
totally
I say that.
fake news. You're making things up. I don't like you anymore, Sam. You're a terrible person. I gotta go.
No, the truth is that
No,
neither
it's true.
person benefits.
I don't think all Republicans are racist, but I think that they make for you to be a Black person. Like, there's a certain level of selling out that they need you to do for them to like put you up front.
No,
And I
all
can't do it.
Republicans are
Like,
not
my
racist.
ancestors will torture me in my sleep.
I'll tell you, all Republicans are not racist, but all Republicans are in a party that supports racist policy.
And so is
So
the Democratic.
you're a
And so
same
is
with
the
the Dems, though. The Dems got racist policies
I
too. Like, I
know.
feel like I'm just getting slapped on both sides. I feel like both my parents beat me.
The only
Like,
real
where
difference,
you go?
the only real difference between the two parties is that they made a conscious effort. Remember, there was no one, you know, just like Clyburn is very powerful in the Southern Black communities. The same was true for Strom Thurmond when it came to the white communities in the South and the GOP behind, you know, sort of the movement that, you know, Reagan and Barry Goldwater started was are going to dominate the South and work because of, you know, what Kennedy was starting with the civil rights movement. Mm-hmm. They're like, oh, well, this is our opportunity to swoop in and get this part of the population. It's almost like, no, that the parties didn't change. They just seized on an opportunity with people who were living mm-hmm. where they were to get them to vote for their side. I can still remember going to Orlando back in 2017 when Gillum had just gotten in the race for governor and listening to the old white biddies talk about, they'll never vote for a Black man for governor. You're showing your hand. You're saying right now that, no, you are actually a bigot and you won't vote for him. Your attitude is supposed to be, he is the best candidate, which he was, and we're going to support him and make sure he wins instead of staying the cover crap behind the scenes.
So the funny thing is you said that I'm pretty sure there's a bunch of Black people who said the same thing. Can we just say that we have a lot of skeptics around? Because I get that from reparations. People are like, well, I believe you should get it, but I don't think it's ever going to happen, so I'm just not going to bother with it. And I'm like, well, could you just not? I'm like, well, so you'll be neutral? You'll just shut up? If you'll just shut up, that's great. I'd rather you be neutral than be against. But yeah, no, that happens all the time. I think a lot of people understand we still live in a racist country. And I think everybody is just trying to, like, do you guys watch Iron Me at all? Iron Me Osei Frimpong?
No.
Oh, you gotta watch Iron Me. You'll love Iron Me. You should have him come on. He talks a lot about, like, whiteness and the white family. But he basically talks about how, like, everybody's afraid of poking the bear, which is white supremacy. Like everybody, white people, Black people, because if the bear comes loose, it can kill us all. And that's what people are really worried about. And he talks about it all the time. Yeah, you guys got to watch some Iron Man.
I do.
I know it's hard when you do a show all the time.
No, but it's also...
I'll email you all the stuff.
Yes, please.
And I think this is a great place to wind down the conversation. It's this whole idea of whether it is a Joanne Reed, whether it is, a Jonathan Kay part. I mean, we could go through the list, but the truth of the matter is they're part of that class, which is mm-hmm. I'm going to do whatever I have to do to protect my class. When the rarity mm-hmm. comes along, like an Ed Schultz or a Phil Donahue who says, no, my principles are more important than continuing to further this message. Ed Schultz was always a progressive, but there was no real non-corporate progressive who was running. When Bernie finally decided to run, Ed was making it his mission in life to get Bernie's message out there. And when MSNBC said, you are not doing this, he said, take this. Mm-hmm. And he was the only one who was willing to do that. Everyone else, like a Rachel Maddow, who if you listen to her when she was on Air America, you would think she was a super progressive. But then the money came along. And then the opportunities came along.
That's it.
And that's it. And to the people who need help, the hell with you. I'm high on the hog now, baby. Hello, you're way down there. I see you, but you can't reach me.
And that's so funny. I'm sorry to interrupt you. That's so funny. It reminds me of the Fred Hampton thing where he talks about that's the importance of a political education. Because if you don't have a political education, you won't know why it's important that you're doing what you're doing. And then you'll just want stuff. And before you know it, you'll want more. Then you'll be an imperialist. That shit runs for white people too. It's just funny how that works with leftists as well. Because if you don't have a strong foundation when you get started, you're going to get corrupted by the money.
Sam,
it's easy to buy you.
Look at what Simone Sanders did. I saw what she did behind the scenes back in 2016. I'm like, this person basically called the cops on runaway slaves. She just figured out, oh, I got my opportunity. Goodbye. And then she pulls the freaking race card on people who want to call her out for backstabbing Bernie. It's like this shit doesn't end. And it's not going to until people say, we're not taking this anymore. I don't care what your color is, what you look like, what your sex is, what your pronouns are. I don't give a damn. I just care if you're on the level or not. And if you're not on the level, you've got to be called out on it. And that's as we always say on this show, the unifying issue of our time is corporate special interests controlling our government. And until we identify that that is what is preventing reparations, that is what is preventing universal health care, that is what is preventing a living wage, and that is what is preventing us from having a robust climate plan to save our goddamn planet, it is never going to happen until we unify around this issue. And the more we try to figure out these little nuances about, oh, you're not progressive enough, you're not conservative enough, we're all going to hell. And I don't want to go to hell. I want to live on Earth and enjoy my time.
Thanks for watching. If you want to support our mission to transform politics into service, please like this video, subscribe, follow us on social media, and consider joining our Patreon, where you'll get early access to our interviews as well as other exclusive content. Links are in the description. Peace out.